So you want a SELinux policy configuration that you designed and created from pretty much scratch. And you want it in a way that is easily maintainable. So I created a couple of files. I created a RPM spec file for policy query details that basically strips the unnecessary stuff from Fedora's policy query details package. Basically, it strips it down to a couple commands: secon, load policy, restore con, set files, se status, and it keeps the package lean and small. And so, this is enough for this configuration, for this implementation. So let's go to CD. RPM build sources, and just wget the source, and the source is based on policy query details 2.3 RC1. So this is probably not in Fedora yet, so you also had in this case an updated version of policy query details. And let's just get it. Next thing you'll do is basically you'll get the spec file here. Copy it over to and I'll just copy it and nano specs. You need to put that in your specs directory, and also I also assuming that you know how RPM works, policy query details spec. So here's your spec file. And then finally, we need to actually get the patch file. There's also a makefile patch included in this repository that basically allows us to only build what we need, because else you'll need to pull in a lot of dependencies, and that's not needed for the commands that we want to makefile patch in the sources directory. And this should take care of everything. So you might want to do a RPM build dep or RPM build build dep or whatever it is that basically, or I'm not sure, but you might want to make sure that you have the dependencies, but you'll see that soon enough if you run this command rpm build ba and then specs policy query details details spec. And it's created a policy query details package. A much more slim one than Fedora provides. A lot of these commands that Fedora provides don't work with this implementation. This implementation of us, of ours, we're using the common intermediate language. This is a new policy language layer, I suppose, new policy language, I suppose. All right, so we took care of policy core details. Next, let's just do the same for SESLC, which is the SEL compiler, the common intermediate language compiler. Now, basically, we just need the spec file. We need to actually get the file here. So you can get that here, copy it, go to sources, and then wget again. And then replace the short commit with the what's defined for the short commit. The short commit is the first 7. The first 7. So that's probably this. Yeah. And then replace it there and then just get that file. And that downloads the source. Then we need to actually have this spec file. And we copy the spec file to ORI nano specs. SESLC spec. Save and exit, and then just RPM build, but then this time SESLC spec. And again, if you have if you don't have dependencies, you'll see soon enough. And that'll create the SESLC package. Okay, last but not least, we need to take care of the policy. And the policy so let's look at the SEL base. This is SEL base policy. Basically we need to get the source. So we go to here again, we paste in the source URL and we replace the commit with the actual commit tag, and that is the latest available from GitHub, I suppose. And wget, not just, and that gets the latest source for the SEL based policy. Then actually just get the spec file and then create a nano specs SEL based spec. Paste that in, and that'll take care of that, I suppose. Make sure you have the dependencies, but you'll see soon enough. And then SEL base spec. Oh, CBase, SEL base. And that'll build the very, very small policy. So now we have a bunch of RPMs. Some of them are no arch and some of them are x64 in my case. LS no arch. And LS x86. So we have SESLC, we have policy core details, and we have SEL base. Next up is let's just create a virtual machine to test this out in and show you how to set this up. I have the script and I'll just open up a new shell, cd git gen.ks, and you don't have the script. And it's on GitHub, my GitHub page, but it needs heavily modified. It needs to be heavily modified. But you can just set up one manually. Just I would just basically keep it as small as possible, the installation. So use a text only minimal installation, and yeah, just a Fedora 20 minimum installation, as minimal as possible, of course you want that. So blah blah blah, does this look good? The script basically creates a kickstart file with a bunch of defaults in there. That should probably be fine. And then we can actually do sudo git gen.js and then sil test, that's the name. And then with the extension of network 3 that's appended automatically, I have a bunch of virtual networks and actually also physical networks. So, and then there's a disk path, and it's a dev SDM3, I think, I hope. No, I hope we don't override anything. This should actually proceed to install. Oh, actually, still test install, it's just install, I suppose. And this should install, so it shouldn't take too long. First console, and then sil test network 3. Oh, and that needs sudo, of course. It's installing. Shouldn't take too long. But it's basically a minimal Fedora 20 installation. This is basically what you should do, but this is done automatically, but this is like text-based install. Takes a short while. And then when, after we install the system, we want to update this to the latest available Fedora. So we'll do a YUM update. Because this policy, this SIL-based policy, does have some caveats. It's a very minimal, it's designed to be just a starting point for people who want to basically create their own customized policy that's basically tailored to a particular system or a particular set of systems. And so it doesn't have much, it has just enough to get you started, basically, to boot up in a forcing mode, have some types there, and have the files there, and the compiler there, so that you can basically start modifying it. But there are some issues with Fedora, where some programs in Fedora basically make some assumptions with regards to some as Linux identifiers, as Linux types and contexts. They assume that those contexts exist and make decisions using those contexts. And so, for example, RPM has some knowledge inside of there that basically thinks that there is a type RPM script T for RPM scriptlets. So when you install a file, or basically install a file with YUM or RPM, then RPM will try to run the post install scriptlets or the scriptlets inside the RPM script D domain, but that domain doesn't exist, and then it just craps out. So if you're doing this if you're doing a huge update after you install the policy and you aren't aware of that, then all the files that you updated are will fail. All the post installation scripts will fail, and you'll end up with a corrupted system. And so that's one thing to keep in mind, that if you install this policy, until you fix it or deal with the RPM issue, you might want to do updates in permissive mode, because else you'll corrupt your system. And yeah, it just sucks, but basically boils down to that you'll just have to introduce probably the RPM script T domain, and then you'll have to probably have to allow whatever user is running RPM to roll transition or change and type transition or change to RPM spec T or RPM script T and the system R role probably. System R role is available, but the RPM script T type isn't available. So, domain is not running. Verge start zip test network 3. Oh, and I need the O. Yeah. And it's booting. So we want to update the system and then get the IP address and then start from work from SSH from that point. So root ABC123. I'll just do this as root. Yeah, update. And that'll update the system. It's a minimal system, so it shouldn't take too long. Well, I did install a couple of extras in the kickstart file. Not much. New kernel. Still to unpack. Oh, we have a system journal. We received the request of flush runtime journal from bit 1. No, doesn't look like an error, but some kind of message. Now, I'm not actually sure if this procedure works if you do a graphical install. Probably not. Or well, you probably will be able to hack around the stuff there as well. But there might be some extra dependencies there. I know at some point I will actually implement this on my laptop. Probably, I'm going to probably try this with Red Hat Enterprise Linux 7 RC. Because this should work on RHEL 7, and if you do, then you will have a pretty nice implementation. If you're familiar with SE Linux and not afraid to do a lot of work with SE Linux, then that's a pretty nice implementation. There's just so much disadvantages with using the default implementation of SE Linux. First, you end up with a huge policy, and most of the policy you won't ever use. And you want to edit something that is inside the policy, you won't be able to do that unless you compile your own policy anyways. So you won't be able to make a real fundamental changes. You'll just be able to add on some stuff. And the policy might just not fit your requirements. And with security, it's all about fitting your fitting your requirements, your specifics. Okay, so this is done. IP. Okay, and I have an IP address of 163. Shut down, reboot now. I don't have a. How can I get out of this console? No clue. Anyways, that doesn't really matter. Let's find another. So we have 163. So let's just start by pulling this stuff up. Let's just start with no arch, cd no arch, and then just the sftp joe at 192.168.200.163, yeah, and then just put the sill base policy rpm file there. That's done. Then LCD x86-64. LLS. Okay, and then put all of them, two packages. And put SECLC. And then quit. And now we can actually SSH inside into the system. And the packages should be there. Yeah, they're there. So we're currently dealing with the Fedora as Linux implementation. There's a couple things we want to do. So I'll just, for now, sudo shell. And let's just see what happens if we try to get rid of policy core utils, yum arrays, policy core utils. If that's easy. And there's no dependency, so that's easy to remove. Let's see what else we have. Curial, grep, SELinux. So we might actually be able to get rid of libSELinux Python. Yum arrays. Live SELinux. Oh yeah, this is actually funny. There's actually a dependency here. Firewall D actually depends on that. Now we'll just get rid of Firewall D, and instead we'll just install yum install IP tables services. Yeah. I used to like Red Hat for its vision, but in this case, with regard to Azure Linux and stuff like this, I really think they lack the vision. Anyways, I have a configuration for myself for IP tables. And then system control enable IP tables. Enable IP6 tables and then system control start IP tables and then IP tables list. See that? Yeah, that looks good. So now we just change to IP tables just in order to get rid of the Python bindings of Azure Linux, because, well, we don't want that. We don't want any Azure Linux related stuff in Python. It's C or the highway. But it's not that easy. So let's just go back and see what we currently have. So we have Lib Azure Linux Utils, which is a requirement. And we have Lib Azure Linux, which is a requirement. And then we have the Azure Linux policy packages. But we have more. We also have Azure Manage. We have Lib Azure Manage. Now this, we can't remove this. I would really want to remove this, but first of all, Lib Azure Manage owns, I'll show you that. Owns etc Azure Linux. Now that's just so fucking weird. I mean, that's just terrible. This is already one thing that we need to keep Lib Azure Manage for, because our policy needs to be in etc Azure Linux, and etc Azure Linux is owned by Lib Azure Manage. So from that perspective, we can't get rid of it. But even if we could, Lib Azure Manage or Shadow Utils depends on Lib Azure Manage for a stupid functionality that we can't use anyway with this implementation. There's this user add dash capital Z option that allows you to basically add a new Linux identity to the system, and then in the same go associate that Linux identity to a specified Azure Linux identity, and that'll basically associate the Linux identity with the Azure Linux identity, and then as a consequence of that, it needs to generate new home directory context for that user, because that user is automatically not associated with the default Azure Linux identity, and thus home directory context will have to be generated for it. But yeah, this functionality we can't use that anyways. So that user add capital Z doesn't work with this implementation anyways. And we don't want that. We know what to do. We don't need that automatic easy stuff. We want to just do that ourselves manually. But anyway, so but yeah, then you could say, okay, well then just build Shadow Utils without the Lib Azure Manage dependency, but that's not really possible either, as far as I looked quickly, because there's this dash dash use Azure Linux flag for Shadow Utils, but that basically also gets rid of the Lib Azure Linux stuff. So there's no way to say, okay, give it some basic Azure Linux support, but not that stupid Lib Azure Manage support. And that's so stupid, because if you want a small footprint Fedora installation, then you want to probably have a, like for example Fedora Embedded, then you probably want to have a a small footprint. So you don't want, you want a monolithic policy, and a monolithic policy doesn't work with SE module and SE manage. So you don't need Lype SE manage for that. So you want to get rid of that so that you have more space for your system. But that's not possible because these fundamental utilities, shadow utils, depends on as you manage, and you can't really get rid of it easily, because if you do, then you'll also get rid of the Lype as Linux dependency, and that might actually be needed for some reason. I'm not sure about that. That's an assumption, but anyways, I just decided to just leave as you manage on the system. But it is a sorry situation, also because Lib SE Manage owns etc SE Linux. That's just nuts, in my view. So we're here. We have removed as much as we can, except the policy. So we are in get enforce. We are in permissive mode. Oh, we are not in permissive mode. So let's go to set enforce 0. And then to confirm that, because we are going to remove SE Linux policy. So yum arrays SE Linux policy, SE Linux policy target. And that'll take care of that. Now ls alt etc SE Linux. Now, as you can see, the package hasn't actually removed the targeted directory. It left some stuff, probably for a reason. We don't actually do that. I don't understand why netfilter context needs to remain there. That's just a bug, I suppose. And as users again, RPM save, so it saved that. But anyways, cd etc. Yes. The SE manage conf is owned by lib SE manage. We already saw that. Let's get rid of rmrf targeted, because that's just the bullshit. And config, let's have a look at the config. So it says, okay, SE Linux is now disabled because we deinstalled the policy, and without policy it can't be enabled. And the policy type is still set as targeted. All right, so let's just proceed and install our packages. cd.go. RPM UVH RPM. And this is this is one issue, small issue, but that's not a big problem. Basically, in the post installation scriptlet. The sealbase scriptlet. It says, okay, on install post, try load policy. And here it says if as config. So basically, it says if there's no config file, then install one. But if there is one, then do nothing. And we should actually, if there is one, we should actually replace the SE Linux type with our type, SE Linux type. But anyways, it didn't do that. And then it's loading policy, and then it says, yeah, okay, I can't find targeted policy. And that's true, because target is still in nano etc ANSI Linux config, it's still set to target here. But we want to set it to our new policy, and we need to change it anyways because we want to enable it again. So we need to set this to, what is it? Sealbase. And then set this to enforcing. So yeah, that's a bit of a hack. It probably can be done better. And then we can just load policy, hopefully. And this might take a little while. Oh, it's actually not that bad. And then we should restore on RVF, the full file system. I didn't package fix files with my policy core details, so you are required to do this like this. And it will relabel the whole file system. So now if you look at it, the whole file system is set to systemd except proxy, but that'll be taken care of once you reboot, because that's still set to an old initial sit type associated with an old initial sit. And the weird thing is that type, this type doesn't exist in policy anymore, but it hasn't reset it. It should have reset it. So this is kind of a weird issue, this property issue. This is kind of not right. Anyways, so PS out and everything is set to systemd. And there's also some weird things going on here, where some stuff ends up with object R role. But you need to reboot anyways. Shut down, reboot now. And if all is well, we'll reboot straight into an enforcing ANSI Linux. Socket activated, so we can just connect and wait until SSH starts taking over the systemd socket. That's nice stuff. Let's just sudo shell abc123 and ID, look at our context, which is session u, session r, session t, get enforce, and we're in enforcing mode, so it booted fine in enforcing mode. Assert MHCTS 1341 or 40. There's no AFC denials at all. PS out. And everything seems to be in the right domain. It's all either system U, system R, system T, or session U, session R, session T. There's no more object R's in the list of processes, which means that's fine. Then LSRT, let's see if we got rid of that proc stuff. And proc is now also labeled system use object R system T. So that's also taken care of. So now we have this stuff taken care of. So let's have a look at what we installed. RPM query list SECLC. Very small, just the binary and the license. Let's have a look at policy query details. Very small SE status configuration, SECON utility, load policy utility, restore con utility, SE status utility, set files utility, license, and some manual pages. And then let's look at our policy, which is what is it, Sealbase, and this has installed a bunch of files. So it basically owns etc ANSI Linux Sealbase and pretty much everything below there, which is some default configuration files, context files, I suppose, the actual policy database, which is compiled already in it, just was just copied over from the RPM. And then we have an SE users file, which sets up the default SE users, as Linux identities. And then we have the source, because in this configuration, we have the source installed by default. It's just there, always. And that's just a decision I made. You can actually, if you have an embedded system, then you should probably just remove the source, but this is not a implementation designed to be for that specific thing. This is an implementation for basically install once and then just modify it on the fly. So now we should just basically be able to create a modification. So let's just edit some file. Actually, let's just edit something in the system because there's already types declared there. I'm not truly familiar with the syntaxes yet, but for example, let's just create a stupid type. My type T, and then there's this, and then this the role type system R, and then my type T, whatever. It's just an example anyways. Role call, this is an interface object R, that's already there. This is, yes, weird thingy, but need to get used to that. And then my type D. Okay, so we had just, all we did was just created a new type there. And now we can actually use SESLC. And then you set that to allow by default. You can basically write a wrapper script for this. And then basically the out file is etc se linux sailbase policy 29. And then the file context file is etc se linux sailbase contexts files. And then file context. And then we need to actually get etc se linux sailbase source, and then listings. And where is that? That's probably your listing. And there's basically pretty much replaces the policy, and then you can just do load policy, and now the policy should be there. So if I, for example, now we are in a forcing mode, and I made a note before that installing packages in a forcing mode will not work, it will fail terribly and correct the system. So we'll now install SE tools, see if we can install that to query the policy, because, or actually, we need it? The info. Yeah, we do. We need that. Set it for 0, and then yum install SE tools console. Hopefully, it doesn't have any terrible dependencies. If you do this in enforcing mode, it'll fail. Set enforce one, back to enforcing mode, and now look at the info T. And now you see that my type is actually in there, the type that we just created. So you can actually just basically modify the policy from scratch there. You can do modifications that otherwise you wouldn't be able to do. For example, if you want to create a port type and actually also add a port context specification, you can do that. Previously, you wouldn't be able to do that without actually modifying the SE Linux policy package. Now you can do it. The source is all in your system. You can just modify a file or create a file, add it to the listing, compile it, load policy, and be done. Now, there's a lot of things to type there, so you should just script a lot of stuff. For example, you could create a bash script that basically compiles a specified list listing of modules, and then automatically runs load policy after it does that. Then basically bang, bang, everything is updated after you run that script. So a lot of wrapper scripts for that. And we also need to create a script that replaces the old gen-home-dir-con script. Basically, as soon as a policy is built, new home directory context or user file context should be generated. And the same if you add a new user with a customized identity, then that same script should be run so that the context specifications are updated to reflect that new custom identity and the new user. So yeah, there's a lot of scripting to be done, but that's pretty easy. The gen-home-dir-con is, yeah, that's a little bit of a relatively large script, although it doesn't have to be that large. But all the other scripts, like for example your own get a cbool and set a cbool scripts, can be really simple. All you do is just parse all the boolean declarations there, and then just that allows you to get a list of all the booleans that are in the policy. And then if you want to toggle something, then just set, use set to change the declaration from on to off in the source policy, and then just build the whole policy again with SECLC, and then boom, the boolean is toggled on the fly, just so that you can be creative with that. No need for C programs, although you could create some nice C utilities for that, of course. But anyways, you don't need the SE module. You couldn't even use currently SE module for stuff like that, or probably the set a cbool wouldn't work. They are working on making SEAL policy work with all those utilities, but I'd still, even if they made that work, then it still doesn't feel right to me, because it's just a hack to make it for distribution vendors to make things backwards compatible, or at least make it compatible. And we don't need no compatibility with the old ref policy or with the old binary format. We are just we love bash scripting, so we'll just create a shell script to do it. It's easy enough. So yeah, now you can basically just create your own policy from scratch. Everything is possible. You can make this by default. This is actually a non-MLS policy, but you can create morph it into an MLS policy or in an MCS policy, or you can implement the user based access control, no problem. Just edit some files in etc SE Linux SEAL base and then source, edit it there, compile it, and you can do whatever the hell it is you want to do. And that's just neat, that's just great, because you know, in normally with Fedora, every other week you get a policy update, and most of the time that update doesn't really affect you because it's just some bug that was reported or a couple of bugs that was reported against some support for some package that you never use or install, but just because the S-Linux policy provided by Fedora covers a whole array of utilities, services, and apps that you never ever use, you'll be obliged, or you're not obliged, you can of course opt out of updating it, but by default you'll get a update notification as soon as the policy is modified upstream, and then of course you'll usually update it, but it doesn't change the goddamn thing for you usually often. So yeah, there's no need to update your policy in that sense. And if you have your own policy, this one here, then you can just update it with simple compiling it and loading policy, and then bang, it's updated. If you have a bug, just fix it, just change it. It's just configuration data, and this actually embraces that the fact that it's just configuration data. It doesn't make it anything more than that. It's just configuration data. So yeah, that's really cool. One other thing that you probably want to do is you want to, if you implement this and work with this, you want to add etc yumconf. You want to add this to the excludes among yumconf, probably not installed. Oh, it is. There's probably allows you to exclude some packages, and you want to exclude policy core detail. Oh, here you have it. So here you have exclude the list of packages to exclude from all repositories. So yum works as if that package was never in the repository. This should be space separated list. This is commonly used package, blah 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 blah. But you can use them. Blah blah blah. This can be disabled using this. Okay, so exclude and then exclude is policy core details because we're using a customized package. And we don't want Fedora to replace that with a, accidentally when you do a yum update, you aren't looking carefully. You don't want that package to be replaced by the Fedora package. See if it fails, doesn't fail, seems to be able to parse the yumconf. So yeah, that's basically it. And now you can just start hacking and doing stuff. And like, for example, it allows you to keep the policy really simple. Like for example, the first two processes, the kernel threads and systemd, you can't really confine either of those two. So why create a type for that? I mean, that just makes the policy bigger. So you can just basically leave all the processes that you don't want to target, systemd, and just start targeting stuff. Now, for example, SSHD barks in dmessage or in journal, if you do journal, control B. Then you see that once I log in, it's the SSHD starts barking. Here, this setfilecon operation not supported. Basically, it's probably hard coding. It's probably something hard coded. And here as well, here it says SSH Linux change context, and then it says setcon system u system r sshd underscore net t from system d system system u system r system t invalid argument. And that's because SSH has this context here hard coded inside of it, and it's basically trying to change from system T to SSHD net T, but it can't because that type doesn't actually exist, that context doesn't actually exist in the policy, and that's so it's barking. So yeah, one thing you might want to do just to get rid of this message is to just create a domain for SSH and then just implement that SSHD net T type, and then allow SSHD to dynamically transition from SSHD underscore T to SSHD underscore net underscore T, so that that message gets can get rid of. And the same goes for that, as you said, a PTI. It probably has some PTI type hard-coded. And because the type doesn't exist in the policy, it fails. Probably something like that. So yeah, those are things that you might want to just fix, just to get rid of the warnings in your messages stuff. And the same goes for RPM. You might want to just create some types for RPM just to get rid of that RPM, and then just create some transition rules to get rid of that RPM thingy, because well, it's nasty. All right, that's it.